Hello and welcome to episode 3, part 2 of the Chris Haas Show. I'm Chris Haas. Thank you so much for joining me today. And as always, a very special thanks to those of you that have liked and subscribed to my YouTube channel. If you haven't, please go ahead and do so. You can also find me on Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn. So as promised, here we are today in part 2 of episode 3, where we're going to continue to talk about the onboarding documents. Let's do a quick recap from last week when I went over the basic documents with you that you would see in a car dealership. We talked about the state-specific documents for your taxes, some federal documents, and a few other basic documents. And we left off with what you usually see in the employee policy manual. So let's jump right into that employee policy manual and talk about the documents that most likely you're gonna see. So you're probably gonna see a document that says OSHA on it, the Occupational Safety and Health Administration form. So that also may have a small pamphlet that you're gonna wanna read along with that. That just simply talks about safety for yourself in the workplace. So you're gonna wanna go ahead, review that, and sign, print, and date that. Next up, you'll normally see a document, might be a bit wordy, you know, talking about anti-discrimination and no retaliation, anti-harassment. You know, ultimately what this document has to do is about being kind in the workplace to others. And, you know, this should be self-explanatory, but be very careful with the words that you choose. There are things that you may think is a joke that can be considered sexual harassment or harassment to one of your coworkers. So again, read through that document and see what those dealers' expectations are. It really should be common sense. You know, remember that platinum rule, right? Just treat others the way you want to be treated and be careful with what you say in the workplace. Next up, the immigration law compliance and acknowledgement form. So back in part 1 of this episode, we spoke about the I-9 documents. This form usually is there for you to sign and attest to the fact that the documents that you provided, right? Those documents we talked about, your driver's license, social security card, or passport, that they all were indeed original and valid documents. The payroll deduction authorization form. So this is unlike the ACH form, the direct deposit form that we spoke about in the first part of this episode. This episode is going to be for your credit union deductions, if there is one, the employee savings plan deduction. Now, keep in mind, there also may be some verbiage on here about collections or judgments, meaning that if there is something out against you and they contact your employer, you may be signing on that document that they have the right to garnish your pay. I mention this because if there is something outstanding, maybe try to get that taken care of if you can before the employer gets contacted about it. Next up, workers' compensation policy acknowledgement. I would, you know, quickly read through this and see what the workers' compensation laws look like in your state. They do vary. It's certainly good to have some basic knowledge of it. The employee receipt of workplace violence policy and a consent to search. You know, on this one, we kind of already spoke about this earlier about harassment, right? Common sense. You certainly don't want any violence in the workplace. But here, this is more about the search that I'm going to talk to you about. Use caution what you bring to work with you, not only in a locker if it's provided to you or in your desk drawers, but in your personal vehicle too. You know, that personal vehicle that you drive in is on company property. If something were to happen, you could have a search of that vehicle. You know, just make sure there is nothing at work or in your vehicle that you wouldn't want your employers to find. Next up, drug and alcohol policy acknowledgement and consent form. So I had mentioned in episode 1, right, about driving. We are driving vehicles, company vehicles at the dealership, and most likely a dealer is going to want you to sign off on a document stating that you are not taking any narcotics or any drugs that may be mind-altering, even if they're prescription. and that you're certainly not going to be drinking or using alcohol while you're at work. You know, this form also would give the dealership consent to drug test you if they have not done so already. You know, simple fix to this. Don't take drugs and drink at work. If you do take drugs and alcohol, I mean, certainly don't do that before your shift. Pretty common, you know, sense there, and you won't have any issues. And again, this really is something that is very serious and important because you are driving company vehicles at work. Next up, you'll normally see a document that talks about computer and communication software and a code of ethics. You know, I remember back at one of the first dealers that I worked at, this is before all these cell phones and could do recording, and there were Bluetooth devices available, but folks would tape baby monitors under the desk so they could listen to what the customers were talking about when they walked away from the desk. You know, don't do that stuff. It's a bunch of nonsense, but most likely a dealership is going to have you sign an agreement stating that you are not going to be doing things of that nature. So again, common sense, I'd stay away from that nonsense. The timekeeper acknowledgement form. So most likely you are going to have to clock in and out. You may do that through the CRM or through the dealer's DMS system, or they may have the good old fashioned time clock that you punch into. Make sure you're aware of what the expectations are with that and you do follow along. The acknowledgement of receipt of the minimum wage reporting policy. Now, we do work on commission, but usually there is a certain amount and it varies by state that you're entitled to weekly. We have up here the most up-to-date for 2020 minimum wage policy. So just give that a quick read, be aware of what you're signing. And again, make sure you sign, print, and date. Be careful with all these documents. Again, this is just the start of a lot of documents that are going to have to be completed when you sell a car. So make sure you do a good job with these so that the office manager's not running back and forth to you asking you to redo these documents on day one. Next, the training policy. Now, usually what this refers to is the testing policy. If you are in a new car store, the manufacturers have tests that you have to take and that you have to score a certain percentile on. So some dealers have a policy, let's say that if you're not scoring 90% or more on your tests, that you may not be eligible for bonuses or for full bonuses. So make sure you read that document, keep that in mind. Study your product knowledge and do a good job on your tests. We're going to get into that in the next episode also. I'm going to start to help you with your self-training and what things you can do to learn the product and score 100% on all those tests. Next, the disclosure to obtain a consumer report for employment purposes. Now, if the dealership hasn't done so already, they may pull a background check on you and also a credit check. Now, back in episode 1 and 2, we discussed this. If there is something in your background or there is an issue, be upfront with that on your job application. Car dealers are some of the most forgiving and understanding people in the world. I know many of them personally, and they're more than happy to give somebody a shot, even if you've had something that happened in your past and you're honest with them. So make sure you've been forthcoming. And again, just go ahead, sign off on that document, print and date, do a good job with that. The employee acknowledgement and agreement to comply with information security. We touched on this a little bit earlier, right, about safeguarding with those conversations and so forth. Now, this document usually applies a little bit more to something called Regulation M, and I'm going to talk to you about that in later episodes, but just safeguard your client's information. When a client is coming in to purchase a vehicle, they're sharing a lot of personal information with you. They're sharing their driver's license. They're sharing usually a credit application that has their social security number on it. Be very, very careful with those documents. I guard them like they're gold. Make sure they're in locked desk drawers. Do not leave those things laying around your desk. Now, that could be a huge fine for the dealership also if a DMV inspector was to come in and find those documents. You have to be very, very careful with that. The uniform acknowledgement form. So we've spoke about dress code, right? A couple of times in the previous episodes. So usually a dealer is going to have you sign off at that point to let you know what the dress code is, if you have to wear a name badge and so forth. Sometimes dealers provide polo shirts for you, or you may have to pay or put a deposit for them and return them upon your resignation from the dealership. So just be aware of that. And again, dress professional. You know, even if you're wearing just the polo shirts at a dealership, make sure they're nice and ironed. You know, that stuff really makes a big difference. Acknowledgement of company's vehicle usage form. I mentioned in the first part of this episode that we'd be talking about this again, right? Dealers usually have several documents that you're going to sign about the usage of company vehicles. So this document usually is a little bit more about not using vehicles for non-company usage. So don't make that stop to the quick trip to grab your Doritos and your soda on the way back to the dealership in a demo. You know, make sure that you are certainly not doing that with the client's vehicle either. So be aware of what the company's policy is on that and adhere to it. Worker injury and illness reporting form. Again, pretty simple document. Just give that a quick read, and it usually states something along the lines of letting your employer know if there is an injury or an accident at the workplace. You have to let them know within a certain time frame, usually right then and there. So make sure you're familiar with that document. The employee confidentiality agreement. So again, there might be some verbiage in here that talks about safeguarding clients' information, and maybe even some verbiage about Regulation M, which, as promised, we'll talk more about that later on. But for now, just keep in mind that anything that is there at the dealership, you cannot take that with you if you decide to part ways. So be very careful with that information, again, that you're receiving from clients. Keep it under lock and key and read through that confidentiality agreement and make sure you understand what the dealer's expectations are. The mutual agreement to arbitrate claims. So this document usually simply states that if you are going to part ways, that you're going to do so on good terms. If there is an issue, you want to try to mediate that before you start getting attorneys involved. You know, I'm highly going to recommend that you never burn bridges. This business, as large as it is pretty small, and things get around real quick. So I would not leave a dealer, even if you're unhappy there with something. Make sure you leave on good terms. And if there is something wrong, try to work that out with them before you, you know, go to court or start getting attorneys involved. Next up, the acknowledgement of the MSDS forms and the location. MSDS stands for your material safety data sheet. You know, I'm typically talking to folks that work in the sales floor here, so this might not apply to you, but it's a good thing to know. I take it for granted because my father was a mechanic and a wholesaler, and I grew up in the shop with him. But there are times maybe that you are going to have to walk through the shop. Just be careful and know when you should be wearing eyewear and gloves if you ever do find yourself in that situation. Usually the MSDS data sheet itself is located in a break room. Normally you'll see something like we have up on the screen here in the dealership. The company website for most dealerships usually has a bio area there. Dealers, if you don't have something like this, I highly recommend it. This is a great way for the employees to write a little bit about themselves, and clients can jump on and get to know the sales team before they get to the dealership. So for the new hires out there, you know, if you're asked, who are you, right? A couple of things that you want to talk about. Think back to the cover letter that we spoke about in episode one. Talk about your hobbies and your interests. For this bio, you might want to talk about your family, maybe your pets, what TV shows you're like. You like what area you're originally from, you know, what brought you to the area that you live in now, right? Just some simple stuff like that. There's just some ideas for you. If you need more ideas on that too, please feel free to hit me up. As I mentioned earlier, I'm available on Facebook, LinkedIn, Instagram. You can find me on any of those platforms. DM me and I'll be happy to help you out. Vacation policy. Read through this, right? Learn how your vacation is accrued and definitely exercise your time off. This is something that I've mentioned before too. We work a lot of hours in this business, so make sure that you exercise your vacation, have fun with it, and enjoy your time off. So read through that policy and learn if there's any floating holidays or so forth. If you have questions, ask the office manager on that one. Usually they're more than happy to help you out. And that's all that we have for today. As always, thank you so much for tuning in. Please stay tuned for episode 4. In episode 4, we're going to start to talk about your self-training and getting into the real fun stuff that I love, the road to the sale and overcoming objections. So again, if you haven't checked out my previous episodes, hop back on over to YouTube and check those out. And I'm always available on Facebook, LinkedIn, and Instagram. Thank you so much for joining me today. Chris Haas out.